everyone. This is Bob Souza speaking from historic Main Street in Somerset Village. SATV Channel 9 is proud to host another episode of Out of the Park. Today's video deals with the life and times of one of the all-time great hitters of the National League, Stan the Man Musial. Played 24 years for the St. Louis Cardinals, 22 of them as a member of the National League All-Star Team. Stan the Man got his start in the Cardinal organization 1938 as a minor league pitcher with Daytona in the Florida State League. He was wild, but somewhat effective because he could throw hard and had a breaking curveball, not of much distinction, but yet part of his arsenal. One day in pregame practice, he was shagging fly balls in the outfield during a rain delay. He slipped on wet grass and landed on his left shoulder. From that moment on, he could not throw with the zip that he once possessed. His manager, former major league pitcher with the Chicago White Sox, Little Dickie Kerr, advised Stan to become a hitter, an outfielder, first baseman. He was a natural hitter, and Kerr had used him as a pinch hitter and part-time outfielder briefly at Daytona. But Kerr is significant in his own right because as a little 5'7" left-hander pitched for the Chicago White Sox in the 1919 World Series. He won two games against the Cincinnati Reds, who won the series 5-3. However, 8 of the members of the Chicago White Sox were involved with the gamblers receiving money for throwing the games to the Cincinnati Reds. Kerr's feat is amazing in that he had to get the Cincinnati Reds out along with 8 of his own players who were helping the Reds by throwing the series. So Dickie Kerr always had a strong feeling for Stan Musial, and Stan also for Dickie Kerr. Stan was elected to the Baseball Hall of Fame in 1969 after those 24 years with the Cardinals. Ford Frick, the commissioner, said he was the ultimate warrior and the ultimate knight. On the ball field, he was extremely tough to beat. Off the field, he was a magnificent gentleman. He was most valuable player in the National League 3 occasions, 1943, 1946, 1948. He won 7 batting titles, and he had 3,660 hits, amazing, which in today's world is good for fourth place. 1,815 hits at home in Busch Stadium, St. Louis, and 1,815 hits on the road. Brooklyn was his favorite place to hit, and whenever he came to bat in Brooklyn at Ebbets Field, the fans would say, "Here comes that man again, Stan the Man." So sit back and observe Paul Hornung's 1973 interview with Stan, with the introduction from the famous announcer Jack Fashenda from football sidelines. We have the voice of God, Jack Fashenda, introducing the program for us today.
Shortly before the Second World War, a baseball legend begins to unfold in the steel town of Donora, Pennsylvania. Stan Musial. three times National League Most Valuable Player, St. Louis Cardinals. National League All-Star Selection, 23 years. Member 3000 Hit Club. Seven times National League Batting Champion. Lifetime batting average of 331. Today, Musial is Senior Vice President of the St. Louis Cardinals and a successful restaurateur. Former Green Bay great Paul Hornung talked with Musial at Hornung's Manhattan apartment and once again at the airport where Musial was awaiting his flight back to St. Louis as they explored the legend of the baseball player who was known to all as the man.
Stan, when we did the show with Mickey Mantle, I asked Mickey who were some of the greatest natural hitters he's ever seen. And he said, well, there was two that I can really think of was, of course, Ted Williams and Stan the Man. And your peekaboo style, it was called, crouching back deep into the box, was that always a Stan Musial trait, even when you were young?
No, it wasn't, Paul. I always had a normal stance, but I always wanted to hit 300 in the major leagues. So when I joined the Cardinals, I kind of crouched down to cut down the strike zone. I was just punching that ball to left field. Although my stance was very unorthodox, I felt very, very comfortable. But the most important thing about a stance is when you come out of that stance, to have a good level swing.
And the follow through, of course.
Right, right. So it's
almost like addressing a golf ball. The pros tell you just to get comfortable.
Right.
And do your thing. You actually created your own strike zone.
Yes, yes. When that ball was outside, I kind of strode into the ball and hit the ball to left field. If a pitch was inside, I tried to hit the ball at all times to the right field. So I didn't try to pull too much. I was a spray hitter.
Of course, in 24 years, your average was over 330, one of the great hitters of all time. And Stan, we've got some film here that I think exemplifies just that. This is against the Dodgers.
The left-hander at the stretch, here's his pitch. Musial takes him the other way and bounces the ball through on the left side. Might get the run home, he does.
The Dodgers for many years had great teams. We had battled one another and had great games and very challenging series, and they were tough. Dodgers had great teams.
Tight ball game tonight, the Cardinals and the Dodgers. The batter is Musial here in St. Louis, and Stan goes after the fastball and drives it deep and far up on the porch. A home run for Musial.
Every game was like a World Series.
Campanella, Reese, Snyder.
Great, great ball players. Robinson
teams.
And yes, great pitchers over there too.
Who's that young guy?
I looked younger, didn't I?
Musial hits a long drive. It's going way, way back in deep left center, and it's gone.
That was a great game against the Dodgers. A lot of excitement, always a great series we had going with the Dodgers. Never a dull moment.
Actually, in Brooklyn's where you got the name Stan the Man.
Yes, so every time we played there, I did such great hitting in Brooklyn that the fans always used to say, here comes that man, here comes that man. So pretty soon it was Stan the Man. There's one of the great hitters of all time, Ted Williams. He was a very scientific hitter. Studied hitters.
Did you ever compare notes, the two of you?
Very seldom, because we didn't meet that often except the World Series time. And
here's a good shot of the crouch.
Here's the pitch. Double pump on the windup. And the pitch. Musial hits a long, towering drive to deep right field, and there's no question about this one. It is gone. A home run into the lower deck.
When you hit a home run, you can generally tell by the feel of the bat how solid it hit, and you could tell how far the ball was going. So I knew that I didn't try to hit home runs, really, Paul. Through my career, I was just trying to meet the ball. And once in a while,
you tell youngsters today that really hit the long ball, would you tell them still to try to meet the ball and never go for the home run?
I would say that if you just try to meet the ball and have the power, that you'll hit more home runs not trying to hit home runs. Because if you're trying to hit a home run, you're swinging too hard, you're taking your head off the ball and moving quite a bit. There's Enos Slaughter, one of the great Cardinal ball players, a great hustler. He loved to play, and Enos was a great Cardinal. He really was.
Enos bangs it through for a base hit. Whitey Karoski at the plate. Here's the pitch. The third baseman bangs it hard. It's a base hit, and Karoski's going to try to stretch it into a double. It's going to be close at second base. And he makes it.
We had a lot of speed in those days. We had a young hustling club. This term weren't bang the ball. We bunted more often in those days. And that's Red Chaney, sir, my roomie. And you know how important good roomies are.
That's
and,
right. Especially after so many years.
Red's our manager. You're right. He's
how many
a great,
years
great
you
guy.
With Red?
Red and I were together about 10 years.
Musial hits a line shot to right center. Chaney will score easily.
And this is Willie Mays getting his 3,000th hit.
Yes.
And a man was on hand.
Yeah, I wouldn't miss it. Willie's been a great ball player all these years, and he's had a great career, and I was happy to be able to be out there to see this Willie get his 3,000th hit. And it's a great feeling to get 3,000 hits. It takes a lot of years, and you got to be healthy and play and be fortunate enough to get hurt. And Willie had a great career there and got 3,000 hits, and it's a great thrill to reach this goal. It was a nice occasion to...
And he's another natural hitter. I mean,
oh,
Willie
yes.
did everything effortlessly.
Willie could beat you, you know, with his bat, with his glove. One of the best all-around ball players I ever saw, really, with his bat, glove, and speed. So he was a good all-around ball player for many, many years. I was coming up to pinch hit here in Chicago. I wasn't due to play this game, and I needed one more hit for 3,000. Freddie Hutchison, our manager, was saving me for St. Louis the next day. But an occasion arose in the game where I was needed to pinch hit.
And the crowd realizing the drama of the moment. Musial going for number 3,000. Right-hander set. Here's the pitch to Musial. It's a fly ball down the left field line that's going to fall in for a base hit. Musial reaches number 3,000. He's going to make it a double. He goes to second, standing up, and the crowd roars.
You know, Stan, during your career, you came through for over 20 years when you made the big play. We're going to come back and talk about it in just a moment. It would seem to me, during your career, you came through when you made the big play.
Well, it would depend on the situation of the game and what you had to do. And sometimes you try to hit a home run, and a lot of times you just try to get a base hit. So, as you say, it's the conditions and situations changes, and you try to build yourself up to these situations.
Musial in that familiar crouch up at the plate, waiting for his pitch. He gets it. Oh, ho, ho! That one's out of here. Over the bunting into the seats, and Stan the man does it again. Home run, Stan Musial.
Of course, some of your greatest days were in all-star games.
Stan Musial loosening up with a little pepper game before the big ball game. Well, we come to a big moment of this ball game now, the batter Musial. Here's the pitch. Stan gets all of it. He takes a look at it. He knows where this is going. Back and over the fence for a Musial home run. Musial got every bit of it. Stan, the man, jotting around the bases, and he'll have a reception committee. A tremendous shot, and he knew it the moment he hit it. Walter Alston congratulates Musial, and the All-Star game is won by Stan the man.
Oh, here's the man they've been waiting for, the most durable All-Star of them all, Stan Musial.
This is the All-Star game in Yankee Stadium. I was about 40 years old, and I got a great kick out of hitting this home run because it was in New York, and the All-Star game, I always enjoyed playing in New York. They're great fans and love baseball, and...
All right, Musial's all set up there in the batter's box. What an opportunity to be a hero. He may be. That one's got home run written all over it. Over the fence, into the seats. A home run right over Roger Maris' head there. Stan the man delivers once again in all-star fashion, receiving the plaudits of the crowd. A great, great all-star, Stan Musial. Great spot for Musial. Go ahead, run on base. Pitcher sets, delivers. So does Musial. Pulls a pitch into right field. That'll score a run.
This is the old Polo Grounds.
Yes.
You loved to hit there, didn't you?
Yes. The fences were short, and I didn't try to hit a ball hard there. I tried to just pull the ball at all times down the right field line. It was 260 down the line, and all you had to do was get a ball in the air, and it'd go for a home run. So this is back in San Francisco again. Juan Marichal is pitching, and he was a great pitcher, had a screwball, and had great control.
Musial at bat, up here in a spot where he can deliver another clutch blow. He swings, he connects. Runner at third scores easily, and the Cardinals are ahead, 1-0. Runner on base, Marichal delivers. Musial lashes out another. This is a drive, and this one may get out of here over the fence at Candlestick Park, and Stan is delivered.
This is home run off Juan Marichal.
Yes, this is in San Francisco. I like San Francisco. It's a great city, and they play a lot of day ball there. And the wind blew to right field, so that's somewhat of a help.
A hero's welcome for Stan the man as he stomps on home plate, scoring behind two runners.
You know, Stan, in baseball, of course, the brushback pitch, the bean ball, has become very, very prominent. It's been a controversy for years. How many times did you know going up to bat that you were going to be brushed back?
Oh, every once in a while, yeah, Paul. They would brush your back and hit you on occasions. And, of course, the pitcher's trying to protect the hitter, particularly if, you know, you hit somebody on their side. So it... There's Willie Mays getting hit here. I'm sure that something went on there, whereas he might have been trying to pitch him inside and the ball got further in there. But every once in a while, the pitchers get heated up in the heat of battle and, hit a guy, and they in turn hit one of our guys. So it's part of the game. But as long as nobody gets seriously hurt, why, that's the main thing.
Now it's pitcher versus pitcher. Gibson at the plate. Marichal delivers. Down goes Gibson. And out goes the umpire. He is charging Marichal. Marichal's coming off the mound to face the umpire. Alvin Dark runs out. He's going to try to argue on behalf of his pitcher, but I'm afraid it's too late. Marichal is being thumbed out of this ball game.
This is our last game in St. Louis. Jim Maloney is pitching, and this is my final game. And the first time up, I struck out, and I was worried about getting a hit in my last game or two, but I did come through with two hits.
Exactly the same way you started 24 years ago.
Yes, I felt like making a comeback after those two hits. This is our locker room coming upstairs, and for the last time, and I hated to give it up. You're giving up something you loved to do all these years, and baseball is a great game, and I enjoyed it.
And of course, for any baseball player, the greatest honor that you can achieve is your introduction into the Hall of Fame.
Yes, it was a great thrill, Paul, to reach baseball's Hall of Fame. It took many, many years of playing, and it's a dream and an ambition, and when you get in the Hall of Fame, it's really a great thrill, and all my friends and family were there, and I was quite honored by baseball, getting into baseball's Hall of Fame. After playing 24 years, I took a little time giving this speech because I had a lot of things to cover. It was a hard and difficult speech to make.
This is not too difficult to take, though. And I don't think there's any other active baseball player who has a statue after him at Busch Stadium. It's a beautiful, beautiful honor.
The St. Louis fans and newspapers and the press and radio and everybody honored me there in St. Louis at this wonderful statue. And I'm very honored by this award here.
You know, Stan, I guess when anyone plays any professional sport for over 20 years, traveling becomes a second way of life, and we're going to come back and talk about your travels in just a moment.
All right.
Stan, all the traveling that you did over so many years, did you have any problems at home? Did the wife ever become a little bit perturbed that you were away from home so much?
Well, not really, because my wife always felt that baseball and traveling kind of went together as part of our life. And of course, while we're traveling there, the girls are raising youngsters, and so they must be more or less a mother and father while we're on the road, and they must have a lot of dedication and understanding. I think we owe the girls a great deal of gratitude, really, for, you know, being both mother and father and raising our youngsters. And I had four youngsters, and I had six grandchildren. I have more time now to enjoy them, and we have a great family.
Stan, in all your travels, not only as an active baseball player in the United States, but as probably the greatest goodwill ambassador we've ever had abroad as far as baseball is concerned. You also went to Saigon in 1967. I understand that impressed you very much.
Yeah, no question about it. It was a very interesting experience visiting our troops over there, visiting the bases, talking to the youngsters, showing them movies, tell them how things were back here in the States, and that was quite an experience. And of course, what impressed me more than anything else about Saigon was that the spirit of our youngsters, they felt like they had a job to do. Their spirit was really great. I was really impressed with their spirit.
They loved meeting Stan Musial, too.
Well, they're great fans, they really were.
How about Japan, I understand? Of course, they're great baseball fans. You went to Japan in 1958, then again in 68. with the St. Louis Cardinals and played the Japanese All-Stars over there. That also must have been quite a trip.
Yes, we, in 1958, I was still playing so that they would entertain us before a ball game, and they're gracious hosts, and they'd take care of our wives, and before every game, they were showered with many, many gifts, and the Japanese, they love baseball. They play quite a bit of it, you know, and they have great legs and great ball players, and so baseball in Japan was very interesting. Some of the fans were different than the fans we have here in the United States. You know, here in this country, in New York or Brooklyn or Chicago, Philadelphia, we have rabid fans. They yell and holler and or get very emotional. Over in Japan, whenever I see a ball game, they're very quiet and they're very subdued, and they don't show their emotion. That kind of...
Very serious.
Yeah, they take it serious. So that was different.
And after you retired in 1963, a great honor was bestowed on Stan the Man. President Lyndon Baines Johnson appointed you as special consultant to head up the physical fitness program.
I always believed in physical fitness. Even when I was a youngster, my dad impressed upon me the value of physical fitness. And of course, then when President Johnson nominated me to work with the fitness program of the country, working with the youth of the country, trying to improve their physical well-being, well, that was a great honor, and it was a great program. It's still a great program, going very well, and I think now the United States is conscious of fitness. Not only youth fitness, but middle-aged fitness, and I think the program has done a lot to upgrade the physical well-being of the country.
And I guess the original idea had to start with John F. Kennedy. He was very interested in sports and physical fitness.
Yes,
pretty good friend of yours.
Yeah, President Kennedy was a great sports fan. You know, he loved baseball, football. He was into all the games. And I remember one occasion where we played an All-Star game here in Washington, and he invited me up to his box before the game and introduced me to many of his friends and senators. And, you know, lucky enough, during the game, I was called to pinch hit, and I got a base hit. So that was kind of thrilled. Then he invited me up to the White House the next day. And John was a great guy, and I was happy to be among one of his friends.
With President Kennedy looking on today, Stan Musial the hitter. Stan digs in. Here's the pitch from the right-hander. Musial lines it into right field for a base hit. Solid shot for Stan Musial to open the inning. And the president enjoys it.
Stan, I guess the only things left is your goodbye to baseball, which was a great one.
The longest playing career of any major leaguer with one team comes to an end as Stan Musial makes his final appearance in a Cardinal uniform September 29, 1963 at Busch Stadium in St. Louis. The 43-year-old Musial retires after spending a quarter of a century in the Cardinal organization and bows out with complete or partial ownership of more than 58 major league records. Even the kids are given special attention in the retirement ceremonies to pay tribute to their hero, Stan Musial, a guy who always found time to sign autographs and give helpful advice to youngsters or better. Ken Boyer, the star third baseman and captain of the Cardinals, presents Musial with a ring showing his uniform number 6 in diamonds, a number that will never be worn by another St. Louis player, according to August Bush, Jr., the club's president.
Baseball has been my life, and I love baseball, love St. Louis. This is a great organization, and I've had fun all these years, and it's been a great thrill. For me and my family, we want to thank all my close associates here through the years for the many, many things you've done for me, and I just want to thank you very much.
Stan the Man Musial, once a Major League Baseball star of the highest order and now a member of the game's Hall of Fame. When Musial retired after the 1963 season, he had set 55 Major League and All-Star records and had gained membership into the exclusive 3,000 hit club. Today, Musial serves as senior vice president of the St. Louis Cardinals and is a successful St. Louis restaurateur, where he lives with his wife, Lillian. They have a son, Dick, and three daughters, Jerry, Janet, and Jeannie. Long live the man, and long live his legend.
In closing, folks, we are very, very honored in this presentation of Stan Musial. Stan the Man received two awards from different presidents of the United States. He was very close, very friendly with 35th President John F. Kennedy. Met him at the All-Star Game in Washington. Also, President Lyndon Johnson awarded Musial with the title of Director of Physical Education for the nation's program. And of course, Stan the Man visited the troops in Vietnam, 1967, during the battles, and was a source of inspiration to many of our fighting men in Vietnam. Also in the year 2011, President Barack Obama awarded the Presidential Medal of Freedom, the greatest honor to any civilian in the United States.
Stan Musial. His brilliance could come in blinding bursts, hitting 5 home runs in a single day's doubleheader, leading the league in singles, doubles, triples, and RBIs over a single season, 3 World Series, first ballot Hall of Famer, worthy of one of the greatest nicknames in sports, Stan the Man. My grandfather was Stan, by the way, so I used to call him the man too, Stan. Stan Musial made that brilliance burn for 2 decades. Stan matched his hustle with humility. He retired with 17 records, even as he missed a season in his prime to serve his country in the Navy. He was the first player to make, get this, $100,000. Even more shocking, he asked for a pay cut when he didn't perform up to his own expectations. You can imagine that happening today. Stan remains to this day an icon, untarnished, a beloved pillar of the community, a gentleman you'd want your kids to emulate. I hope I've given baseball nearly as much as I've gotten from it, Stan wrote in his memoirs, knocking it out of the park one more time.
Stanley F. Musial represents the best of American sports icons. His name is synonymous with the St. Louis Cardinals, the team on which he played for his entire 22-year career. A perennial All-Star and 3-time Most Valuable Player, he won accolades as a player and championships as a teammate. Nicknamed Stan the Man Musial, he played the game with unrivaled passion, and his humility and decency remain a model for all young Americans to this day.
So Stan was quite a man. Going back to 1997, one of his final visits to the Hall of Fame at Cooperstown, he was asked to play his famous harmonica, and he played Take Me Out to the Ball Game. With that, we conclude today's program. Thank you very much for watching the great Stan the Man.
One of the best hitters of all time, Stan the Man Musial. 22 years, 18 times he hit 300, won 7 National League batting titles. And ladies and gentlemen, a couple of years ago, we asked Stan, the best harmonica playing Hall of Famer ever, to play. You want to bring him back this year?
Yeah!
Can you do it? Did you bring it?
All right, let's play right now.
What do you want to play, Stan?
We're going to play Take Me Out to the Ball Game. We're all going to sing it, too.
Ah! standing slim and tall. Blasting shots into the blue line drives off the wall. What's his name, that batter who stands there with that winning smile? He unwinds and follows through, hits the ball a country mile. It's Stan the man, St. Louis Stan, is loved by every baseball fan. Stanley Frankie Musial, run don't know a pen. Stylish and unusual, congenial man of men. Stan the man has placed his name with the greats who played the game. Greatest I have ever seen, and he did it fair and clean. It's Stan the man, St. Louis Stan, is loved by every baseball fan. Who's that playing peekaboo, standing slim and tall? Blasting shots into the blue line drives off the wall. What's his name, that batter who stands there with that winning smile? He unwinds and follows through, hits the ball a country mile. It's Stan the man, St. Louis Stan, is loved by every baseball fan. It's Stan the man, St. Louis Stan, is loved by every baseball fan. It's Stan the man, St. Louis Stan, is loved by every baseball fan. It's Stan the man, St. Louis Stan, is loved by
Mickey Mantle stayed at our house in St. Louis for a few nights. Mickey was having a very tough time in his life. It was before he went to Betty Ford. He was drinking heavily. We had a dinner, and I decided that it would make Mickey feel comfortable if people he knew were there. So we invited Stan and Lil for dinner. And Mickey said, I don't know how I'm going to do it, but I'm not going to have a single drink all day today or all night out of respect for Stan. I don't want to do anything foolish when Stan is here. And the night went on, and many laughs were had and stories were told. And then after everyone left and everyone else had gone to sleep, it was just me and Mickey sitting there talking well after midnight. And Mickey Mantle, who was a flawed but somehow always lovable man, said something that was searingly honest and also, in its own way, eloquent. He said, you know, I had as much ability as Stan, maybe more. Nobody had more power than me. Nobody could run any faster than me. But Stan was a better player than me because he's a better man than me. Because he got everything out of his life and out of his ability that he could. And he'll never have to live with all the regret that I live with. Years later, ironically, only a year after Mickey had turned a corner and gone to Betty Ford, part of the life that he had lived caught up with him, and he died of liver cancer. I gave the eulogy at his funeral. It was a much different occasion than this one, tinged with much more sadness, because of all the regret and all the sadness that had been part of Mickey's life, and he was only 63 years old. It was an extremely emotional occasion. And people often ask me in the aftermath, how did you avoid breaking down when up there talking? Or did you come close to breaking down? And I told those who asked that, yes, there was one moment, and the moment was this. As you stood there, you'd look out, and I tried not to make eye contact with his family, but everywhere you looked across the church, there would be Whitey Ford, or Yogi Berra, or Duke Snyder, or Reggie Jackson, or Commissioner Selig, who is here today. Everywhere you looked, baseball luminaries who had been connected to Mickey's life, as teammates or those who shared New York or some portion of baseball history with him. And they sat in a special VIP section. Billy Crystal, who idolized him, was there. And they were in a little section down to the right. And at one point, midway through, I just kind of looked up to glance around the room the way you do when you're not looking at anyone in particular and you're looking out over the crowd. And I saw against the wall at the end of a pew, about a third of the way back, by himself, Stan Musial. And in that moment, I was struck by the sheer decency of that simple act. Nobody would have marked Stan Musial absent that day. Never played with Mickey, except in All-Star games, never played against him, wasn't in the same league, wasn't linked with him like Willie Mays was. No one would have marked him absent. And it struck me in that split second as I turned away, because I didn't want to continue the eye contact, because I knew what would happen to me. It struck me that a 74 or 75-year-old man who had battled prostate cancer, had gotten out of bed that morning, had gone to Lambert, gotten on a flight by himself, had flown out with no special treatment to pay his respects to a man who respected him so much, and to try and comfort a family that was in a great deal of pain. None of us are perfect, but Lincoln once called us to heed the better angels of our nature. I think it's always meaningful when you see someone who does that, who more often than not heeds the better angels of their nature. It was yet another moment of simple decency and generosity of spirit in a life brimming with them. And so today, we say goodbye to this great ball player and good man, but we don't give up the memories. How many of you of a certain age will put your head on the pillow tonight and hear the voices of Harry Carey and Jack Buck, the soundtrack of your youth, describing another musical double off the screen, or Homer into the pavilion? How many of you, perhaps too young to have seen him play in person, will nonetheless remember the first dates and all the family gatherings that were arranged appropriately with those familiar six words, meet you at the Musial statue? As was noted earlier, inscribed on that statue are these words: here stands baseball's perfect warrior. Here stands baseball's perfect knight. Well, Stan, as humble as he was great, would probably be the first to say, ah, come on, no one's perfect. Fair enough. But there are some who come a lot closer to that unattainable ideal than most of us. Some of you here may remember Stan Musial's last at-bat, part of a 2-for-3 afternoon in 1963 against the Cincinnati Reds, a single to right field. Others may have heard the radio call of Harry Carey that day. And as Stan settled into the box, Harry said, take a look, fans. Take a good long look. Remember the swing and the stance. We won't see his like again. Harry was right. We never have, and we never will.
Here's Musial. Listen to the crowd again. A base hit would give the Cardinals the lead. First pitch, oh, what a cut he had, and he fouled it back. Hey, he really had a swing at that one. Musial now has had 3,629 hits during his fabulous career. The stretch by Maloney. Low curve. Take a good look, fans. Take a good look. This might be the last time at bat in the major leagues. Remember the stance and the swing. You're not likely to see his likes again. Fastball low and away. Two balls and a strike. Stan got the first hit off Maloney. A single to center. The only other hit was a leadoff double by Flood in the center. Two balls and a strike. Phillies are losing 1-0 in the fourth of Los Angeles. The pitch to Musial. A hot shot on the ground in the right field. A base hit. There's Flood around third. Here's a no throw. The Cardinals lead 1-0. Listen to the crowd. Listen to the crowd. Let's see now. Manager Johnny Keene is talking to Gary Cole. Stan is at first base. He might be waiting for this applause on the hip to die down. They'll tear the joint apart when he trots off the field. He would have gone out the way he came in with a base hit. His first base hit gave the Cardinals a 3-2 victory. Now listen, Gary Kolb is going to replace Musial. There we go. The end of a great career. A standing ovation for Musial. He gave his team the lead, 1-0.
Number 20,
with his second hit.
Running for Musial.
And there it is.
Gary Cole.
Here's the way he racks it up. 3,026 games. 10,973 at-bats. 1,949 runs scored. 3,630 hits. 725 doubles. 177 triples. 475 home runs, 1,950 runs batted in.